waiting for a moment, caught in between 10 and 20, and I'm just dreaming, counting the ways to where you are. I'm 22 for a moment, and she feels better than ever, and we're on fire, making our way back from my.
Tell you the honest truth, Rockbrook really has changed a lot.
Only got 100 years.
You're at the table, sit right at your table, or do you sit in a lump, 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 lump?
In the morning, they'd say, the British are coming, the British are coming, and rode all up and down all the hills on the
board. I remember if you came to a meal late, you had to go and apologize to the head table.
Sometimes 4 or 5 nights a week, I was out in the woods somewhere with Rockbrook Girls.
I had people like Fanny Bell and Jerky and Miss Carrie believing in me, and nobody ever said it. It was just, you felt it. Being at camp and being in their presence made me aware of possibilities that I might not ever have figured out for myself.
The joy of camp to me, I watched young girls who, maybe struggled during the school year. It was just such a wonderful thing to see how they gained confidence over the summer to make mistakes, take risks.
It's a chance for a child to kind of come into their own, be their own person.
So it's really the secret of the whole thing, I think, is that we create this community where you're really just a part of it and accepted right from the get-go. There's something magical about it. Even when they're women that have moved around the world, they think back to this little haven that is the heart of the Little Mountain in Rockbrook.
Once you have experienced the spirit of Rockbrook, guides and protects you wherever you go.
This place has been heaven to me ever since I first came.
Only got 100 years to live.
Nancy Carrier, who was the great-granddaughter of P.T. Barnum, she used to come here with her parents. So she came up here for the summers and then later on inherited the Barnum assets. So in 1921, she started Rockbrook Camp.
Rockbrook's first day was July 6, 1921. The first year there were 5 cabins and a lodge and a small swimming pool and 1 tennis court, I think. No dining hall, so this was the dining hall. The campers came down here 3 times a day for their meals.
And there was a phone, a funny phone in the den that they called it the ringy dingy, and it actually was an intercom to all the lodges in camp.
I think the 2 oldest buildings are Curiosity and Goodwill, and those were homesteads that were found up near Williamson Creek. And they were disassembled and brought to Rockbrook in the early 20s.
When the camp first started, they did most of their traveling with horse-drawn vehicles. They had a few kind of Model T, Model A type things that had been converted, but they used horse-drawn vehicles too. Electricity was here from day one. If you look right below the lake, there's the remnants of a water wheel. and the water wheel generated electricity that could run a light in a cabin. They generated their own power.
There was a desire for girls to, you know, learn how to take risks and hold their own. There was a desire for them to appreciate the nature in their surroundings, and the desire for them to learn how to work together.
Mrs. Carrier was just an outstanding community leader and woman, and I think well ahead of her time. Rockwood was founded right after women got the right to vote.
Mrs. Carrier was a real trailblazer. She was a suffragette, and she helped to found the Brevard Music Center. She brought the hospital to Brevard.
Henry, he was such an opposite. You know, he grew produce for the camp, he raised pigs, he was a practical joker. And so he sort of was her foil, I think. But she was clearly the one who wore the pants.
He had a great big garden, and a lot of corn and tomatoes and produce came out of the garden right into the camp kitchen. So we had fabulous food.
Had strong leadership, and she had a woman who was program director and was here for many, many years, and just a highly revered woman by the name of Ellen Jerky.
Jerky was like the old lieutenant commander in the Navy. She ran it very systematically and was very organized, and Maxine was the heart, and people would go and talk to her, and Jerky was loving and kind, but she was, we'll keep everything going.
I think she was a very principled person, and of course having been away, she's sort of like the regiment, she liked the routine, but I think she could also laugh when things had to be.
Jerky believed in me, and Miss Carrier believed in me. They valued who I was and what I could contribute. And you rise to that sort of belief.
There were different people that stand out in your memories, and staff who were, you know, you could always depend on.
We had a hostess for many years who I think she probably worked pretty close to age 80. Her last name was Kaufman, and everybody called her Kaufman. Helen Carey was a cabin counselor up into her 70s.
I do remember vividly Phillips Shaw.
Rosie Slacks. We were Raz and Flass.
Janet and Charlotte. It was Jarlett, we called them.
Perry Mace.
Elsa and Joe and Vicki Caldwell Best.
Keith driving the Dreamboat truck, a truck with size and benches, and you just sit on the benches.
But oh, they loved to sing about the Dreamboat coming around the bend or something like that.
I see the truck go around the bend, goodbye my lover, goodbye. All loaded down with gals and packs, goodbye my lover, goodbye. Singing bye, hello my Keith, my lover, goodbye. Bye, lo, my Keith, my lover, goodbye. Bye, lo, my Keith, my lover, goodbye. Goodbye, my dream boat, goodbye.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Camp has advanced according with technology and transportation abilities and that kind of thing. So we're able to do a few more things that we couldn't do in terms of traveling out of camp.
One hike, they dropped us off on Rich Mountain, and we were supposed to hike back to camp where we bypassed camp and ended up way down the road and had to come find us.
We were camping at Horse Pasture River, and some strangers came in an old pickup truck and got out of the truck, obviously drinking, had a bottle with them. There were two counselors, and the rest were kids. And I said, go in the tent and stay in the tent. So I confronted these people, and they were kept moving toward me. And they got just a few feet and then suddenly turned white. I was watching their faces and turned and ran to the truck, got in and tore out of the woods. I turned around and behind me were all the kids and the counselors standing there in a line with an axe, a hatchet, three knives, a bunch of firewood. You know, and I said, I'm here as your protector. And they said, you're one of us.
Camp had this huge old, probably World War II, army type tent. We went back right up above Whitewater Falls. We pitched this big old army tent. We had food tins, and so we built a little rock fortress. Well, a big rain came along. Trenches had overflowed. And just as I got up there, the whole tent went. And I said, Paige, there's no way we can drive out of here tonight. So I want you to go find a key to the Whitewater Baptist Church, because that is where we're going to spend the night. So he went off and he came back with the key to the church. They were sleeping on the pews and on the floor and every which way. And we didn't bother to tell the kids until the next day that there's a graveyard back there.
It was a July camping trip with Middlers. And as soon as we got there, we heard from the ranger. By the way, there were two or three bears that were eating picnic stuff here. So be aware, there are bears here. And for dessert at night, they had watermelon. And so those little girls, every 2 minutes, another one had to get up and go to the latrine, and I had to sit up all night watching for those bears. So I asked Jerky if I could have a veto right on all menus after that.
As time went on, we did, you know, rock climbing, rappelling, caving.
We started climbing over here in 72 or 73. And I had taught climbing in the Army, so it's kind of not done that much at camp, so we had to have a special meeting with the insurance people. I had to take them and the directors on a climb, and it worked out okay.
One summer, first full day of camp, and got every single Middler up to Castle Rock that day. We were up there, and kids were sitting there just as nicely, and there was a little bush over here to the side, and one of the girls said, Phyllis, can I have this nice snake skin? I looked over there and I said, well, that nice snake skin has a live copperhead inside. Now you just sit here and we'll start on this end, and one by one you just jump back across and line up and we'll just leave. And the snake will be fine. So that's what we did.
My parents bought Rockbrook from the carriers, and I think it was 1962.
Very soon after that, Ellen Jervy retired, and so it had different leadership for several years.
Phil and Jack Stevenson took over. And then Keith and Elizabeth Whittle took over. And then in 1975, my father asked me if I would be interested in doing it. It was sort of a stunning surprise to me to even think about it. I had a 3-year-old, you know, and a 10-year-old, and a 7-8-year-old. But I decided to try.
One person who really helped to stabilize the camp and keep it going forward was Teed. Teed did an amazing job. First of all, she had 3 children. She ran the camp from her home in Atlanta and then, you know, was here in the summer.
During my tenure, tennis was the rage, so we really worked on those courts, and the courts down at the bottom of camp. horseback riding is always a big sport. Girls really love to ride horses.
She would always have a good staff, and she was really good with the staff. They did what they were supposed to, but they also had a good time. Played what they call pranks on each other.
You know, they spiderwebbed my little cabin going up the stairs. I went up one time and they had a baby pool sitting on my bed filled with water. They took my underwear and put it up on the flagpole. And of course, the one they loved to do was to raid the cold big refrigerator in the dining room. So the cooks would come down and, you know, the desserts were all gone.
That was a good, healthy time for the camp, and that was, to me, the thing that stabilized it the most was that leadership.
I always look back on those days of my tenure as a very special time. And I got to play myself. I've had pies thrown at me. I've been dunked in water things. I've had it all.
There would be the whisper around camp, like, we're going to do a pajama parade tonight.
It's when, like, one whole line will come out.
We would all get out of bed at a pre-arranged time, and we would run out of our cabins.
And they're, like, screaming, pajama parade, and they run down the hill.
We would sing at the top of our lungs out on the hill. When Teague would finally step out onto the balcony and be like, good night, girl.
On Sunday mornings, I mean, it wasn't a parade. It was a mad stampede to breakfast in our pajamas because that's when we had applesauce, bacon, and Krispy Kreme donuts.
We had a shaving cream fight, which was one of the highlights of the summer. And after the shaving cream fight, they'd all come up and go skinny dipping.
Jug band is when all the counselors would come in costume, like dressed like hillbillies. And
they would have like that. Yeah, we'd black out
teeth out and stuff, and we would make up these crazy instruments out of like a piece of bark or whatever.
Pots and pans.
And we'd sing silly songs.
Yeah,
the
spoons.
And the, yeah, with spoons and pots and pans.
It takes a special person to be part of a jug band.
It does, because like you're totally humiliating yourself.
Just the fun of seeing them giggle and do ridiculous things and be silly and dress up in costumes and then do something sweet when somebody's being left out. Seeing how they learn to care about the others. I tried very hard to be a good role model because I thought that was something that they didn't always see.
I actually came over here in 1968. I was doing canoeing in Carolina, and we lost a canoe instructor over here, so I came over here to do canoeing. In 1981, Mr. McConnell asked me if I'd be interested in buying Camp Carolina, so we worked out that I could buy Camp Carolina. And then in 1984, he offered the opportunity to buy Rockwood.
The thing with Jerry was that he always had this ability to seem like he could disappear somewhere. Like he was like the eyes and ears of camp. You know, the times when you're like being sneaky and doing something and you're out, you know, and suddenly my nickname was Downtown Marie Brown from Jerry. And I just remember being out in the dark at some point, sometime I shouldn't have been, and he appeared out of nowhere, downtown. I was like,
feel very strongly that one of the good things about camp is a great opportunity for children to be under the leadership of good role models, and girls need to have women role models. So that's what we had, and I did not attempt to in any way influence any of that.
He would take us on these incredible adventures into the woods. So like that was where I feel like for me, he was really pivotal in really feeling this sense of empowerment and facing the unknown in general, but also in nature. We would go on these night hikes or on bushwhacking hikes where we would, you know, be on these hours and hours into the woods, like we're not sure if we're gonna get where we're going. But there was something about, even if it was that he knew or if he didn't, either way, there was something about that magic of not knowing.
Cars out of camp, but there are no cars in it, and built an access road behind the camp. I very much respected the way things were done, and I respected the leadership, so I was just kind of in the background as a support person.
Well, has anybody talked about cabin squatting? Back in the day, campers did not sign up for activities. You were just given a list of the activities you could choose from on your line. If you were lazy, like I was with some of my friends, we just decided we just wanted to hang out in the cabin. Sometimes someone might like walk up and down and make sure that nobody's in the cabin. So you kind of had to hide out. Cabin calls is when, after lights out, one cabin will say, this is cabin number one, calling number two. And then number two says, this is cabin number two, calling cabin three. But it's like, it can go up and down the line for an hour.
I do remember going on the Kilroy's cabin hike with him, and of course,
I'm sure
I was the redhead. Way up in the mountains, there is this falling down, run down cabin.
There was an old ravine right before you turn right at a spring and went up to Kilroy's cabin, and down in that ravine was an old car, and there was a glove on the steering wheel. We'd always go down there to see it and bring the glove back to camp and put it on the step at night. And the next morning it would be gone. And the next time you went back down into that ravine, it would be hanging on the steering wheel. That was sort of a love story involved in Kilroy's situation.
Kilroy was in love with a redheaded nurse. I think he was jealous of some other lover, and so he was trying to sabotage him coming up the mountain.
And as he was going down into the ravine, it was Cynthia!
And then turns out, when he looked down, the person in the car was
the
his love, the redhead. But the thing that is so spooky is there is a ravine and there is a car.
Well, one of the first ropes courses, and remnants of it, is still at the junior outpost. And we built a fancy one down below that in the open field. And then in 92, we built the Alpine Tower. And the reason I remember that was when Jeff Carter first came here. That was one of the first jobs. He helped me on the ropes course.
I was teaching high school in Athens, Georgia. I took a trip up here with some students. One of the students was a camper at Camp Carolina. So we stopped by and then met Jerry, and then Jerry said, if you ever need a job in the summer, let me know. Thinking I would be over at Camp Carolina. And then when I talked to Jerry a little bit more, he said, actually, I'm going to send you to Rockville.
I started here in 1985 as a CIT. Just thought I would be here for one summer and return for many, many summers in a row as a counselor, head counselor, and just ended up working full time. And I always think that is why girls return to camp, is their relationships with people.
It was very different from my regular life in grad school, that you're around people all the time and you're outside all the time and you're active all the time. So it's really a nice change from what ordinary life is like.
We had our wedding here at Rockbrook at the Hillside Lodge, and it was a lovely, very special place to have our wedding.
It was a weekend.
Yep, we had a whole weekend, and we had reception in the dining hall, square dancing later.
You're the one most likely to succeed.
We came back on as directors in 2006. We were doing the day-to-day work along with Jerry, kind of learning the ropes, and we had a three-year-old and one on the way, so we were very busy.
We were both in our own careers, and we had already kind of decided some things. And we had moved to the area already to do the Castle Rock Institute. He was looking around for someone to start to take over, I think. just to help him run it, and at a higher level. He just kept bringing it up to us. He said, you know, you guys would be good at running this, the camp. Why don't you give it a try? It was more of just sort of a lifestyle that we were wanting to see what it was like.
Essentially my boundaries and how the ways I like to express myself.
Open up and find a way. Give some of your own.
Rockbrook has taught me to be the best version of myself that I can be. I think just like letting, you know, that light inside of you shine.
What I've learned from Rockbrook is how to truly be myself.
Kids, especially young girls, when they're growing up, there's a lot of expectations for them to be a certain way, whether it's to look a certain way or speak a certain way or act a certain way, and they consequently they build up these like a social armor where they're kind of protecting themselves. When they finally realize that at camp that it's okay to be silly, that it's okay to not necessarily have your hair brushed, and it's okay to have mud on your shirt. And people can still like you and care about you and appreciate who you are. That's very freeing for them. And consequently, they feel really good. And that allows them to be more creative and to try things that they might not otherwise try.
Mrs. Carrier's vision about what girls need and about growing up, that whole idea of culture, learning about other people, other ways, but learning about yourself.
It's like that image from Whitman's poem, Song of Myself, where the poetic speaker is standing on a knoll and he says, "My left arm around your waist, my right hand pointing to the public road. Not I, not anyone else can travel that for you. You have to travel it for yourself." So I think you could look at Fanny Bell and Jerky and the Carriers as that poetic speaker pointing me, you know, the proverbial Robert Frost, two roads diverge type of situation. But you have the confidence in whatever choice you make to continue. And when you get knocked down, you have the knowledge that you can arise and keep going. And I attribute all of that type of awareness to my Rockbrook experience.